Yes, it is. We are live. Will you? Oh, here we are.
Yeah,
we are live, and we have with us Kate Gladstone. Kate, could you? Okay. If you can just center your face so we can see.
Is that a little better? I'm just, you know.
Yeah.
Trying to get my phone plugged in so that it wouldn't just, I don't want to run out of battery during this event. Okay.
You can plug in your device maybe. Are you on your phone or?
I am actually on my phone maybe. No, I think this is probably the best way, right?
Yes. Yeah, that's fine.
Yeah. Okay, might have to move it around a little every so often, but I'm hoping, you know, not too much, you know. I just want to make sure that my phone is charged in and stays charged in. Okay, so let's just.
Okay, well, while you're doing that, let me introduce you. Our guest today is Kate Gladstone, and she is a handwriting expert, and Julia Hanna is here with us as well. And Kate, are you ready to tell us your story?
I am. Now, what do you want to know about first? Presumably, since you mentioned the handwriting stuff, you'd rather hear about that first rather than any personal trauma in my life. Although I should say...
Well, I thought what we would do is if you would introduce your knowledge of handwriting in the context of some problems that you personally experienced, and that way we could work into the problems.
Okay. I work with the handwriting. I call myself the handwriting repair, or increasingly often the handwriting intervener, because I work to teach and remediate writing. And most people who deal with handwriting have always had very nice handwriting and have been praised for it. But I did not. I did not really write legibly or even read cursive, actually, until I was 24. I have a variety of neurological issues, you know, which were undiagnosed while I was growing up and even after I was grown up for a while, including dysgraphia, including autism spectrum condition, what used to be called Asperger's syndrome, but I'm told it's actually very likely to be straight, flat out autism.
Yeah.
And I am a very awkward person. And I was the sort of person that I tried very, very hard as a child. And I could stay up till midnight in first grade trying to write 3 sentences, you know, for homework and get them legible. And I would try my hardest. And of course, I would be told that I hadn't done any work at all, that I had just scribbled it out just in that morning, obviously, and that I was lying if I said I had done any work and had stayed up till midnight just writing copy after copy. That was unacceptable. I was sent to the principal because they thought I was just ridiculous and intolerable as a human being in many ways. And
that's abusive. Your teacher was abusive. There's something wrong with that teacher.
Well, except you have to realize I, however, was getting the same treatment from my mother and father, who also were school teachers, although not in the same school I was attending. They were sure that I was just either stubborn or stupid, or it wasn't even trying. They could see that I was obviously trying, but with no productive results, and that makes sense to them. They could see that I was intelligent, but they concluded that somehow I looked intelligent, but really couldn't be, because if I was intelligent, couldn't I learn this? I was plagued with extreme handwriting issues, which were personally and professionally wounding to me. Well, what changed for me? Well, I was in graduate school, actually learning to be a librarian. And at some point, I was at home studying, And I had to take messages, although we had an answering machine. The answering machine was not working that day. And there was some big family event coming up. I forget what, you know, a wedding or, a bat mitzvah or something of that sort. And I had to take messages when people were calling so that when mom and dad came back, I could say, Aunt Shirley called, she can't make it, or this one called or that one called. And my way of taking messages had been just to really write very laboriously five or six drafts until, I got something marginally legible. Well, I realized one day in my heart that I had subconsciously taken to leaving the electronic typewriter on all day, because, that's what we had before word processors, and I had taught myself to type, leaving it on, leaving paper in the machine, typing whatever the message was, and then taking out the paper and crossing it out and writing from that rather than let anyone see that I was, here I was typing a message, that would normally be written, and then hiding the fact that I had typed it. Now, since I was in library school, Long Island University, actually, what I was able to do was I stole time from my studies to go into the library stacks and into the archives of the New York City Public Library and literally look up every book I could find and everything I could find on the history of handwriting, literally almost 500 years of handwriting books, because that is about how long they've been published, literally digging this through them, literally trying everything out and saving and applying what worked and discarding what didn't. My parents noticed the results eventually, especially my father, who himself had, he's gone now, but he himself had similar writing difficulties, although rather less than mine. And he actually encouraged me not only to teach him. I like to say I was my first student and then my father was my second student, but to offer my services to teach people. And my first jobs and my most frequent and lucrative jobs for many years, beginning in 1996, a year or two after I'd worked on myself. Because see, I was born in 1963, worked on myself for a few years starting when I was 24, and when I was confident enough around 1996, I went and offered my services to hospitals where the doctors were facing malpractice issues because of scribbled prescriptions. Now, as it happened, that was the year Viagra came out. And Viagra is not a particularly easy word to write legibly at top speed. And of course, the doctors, were writing 300 or 600 prescriptions for Viagra a day, because once Viagra was invented, about half the population of the world wanted it. So that was how I was able to get jobs. For years, my most numerous and lucrative jobs were in hospitals. These days, they tend to be divided between school children, whom I see privately with one or both parents, so that the parents can work in the intervals between my visits, and older people. And by older people, I mean anyone who is old enough that they're no longer being taught handwriting, but it hasn't worked for them. So this might be 11-year-olds, it might be 20-year-olds, 30-year-olds, 40-year-olds, and these are the people I work with, because I'm one of a very few people who has been where they are, but has the skill that they are trying to learn. So a lot of my day is spent working with these individuals. At the moment, I'm trying to put together a book, which I've been trying to put together off and on for years. It's more difficult than it sounds. Also, a large portion of my day is spent, believe it or not, in writing to legislators, because a lot of the legislators in the USA have been caught up in a sort of lobbying campaign to mandate cursive handwriting, which for a lot of us is just something that does not work. Certainly not for me. It's easy and important to learn to read cursive. To learn to write it was one of the big things that didn't work for me. And I wouldn't mind so much if legislators were mandating something that is really not well designed and is quite difficult, except that it's very frequent for the legislators or the lobbyists who give them information. And yes, there is actually a cursive lobby with more than one branch to literally misquote research to make it defend their point.
Should we be mandating any kind of handwriting, though, Aya, do you think?
I think that as long as there are electric power supplies which can stop working, that's one reason. As long as people are learning to read, there are studies that show that handwriting, any kind of handwriting, is a great facilitator of the process of becoming literate and being able to handle written language fluently, even if what you end up doing is typing. Mm-hmm. However, and these studies, of course, have been quoted and then with reason by a lot of people who want to see some handwriting training in the schools. Unfortunately, what gets quoted and gets misquoted is the evidence that, how shall I put it, that basically any kind of handwriting is going to give you the circuitry that helps with reading. Any kind of motion with a stick that makes
marks. Anything you do with your hand.
But what's really scary, and no one really wants to talk about this, is that a lot of the research that has looked into what are the habits of fast and legible handwriters, given that we should have handwriting, has found that your teacher lied to you. Cursive is not the fastest thing. Okay, it's not even the fastest thing other than shorthand. The fastest and the most legible handwriters are those who join some but not all the letters, making the easiest joins, skipping the rest, and who use print-like letter shapes where the printed and cursive forms disagree. And all of this, you know, is the handwriting habits package, you might say, of highly effective handwriters. It's basically handwriting heresy in 95% of the schools in America that care about handwriting at all. But interestingly, if you look at the history of handwriting, the earliest published handwriting books were like that. The loops and the join 100% of everything that we think of as being essential to handwriting or essential to cursive came in much later as a stylistic development. And it blows people's minds when I show them pages from handwriting books 500 years ago and show them step by step, for instance, with books 400, 300, 200, 100 years ago, how it came to the state that we have today. And in fact, at one time in my life, I actually got a death threat. I think it was a joke, but it was worded as a death threat by someone who said, "I teach cursive, and what you have discovered is probably right, but it should not be allowed to be right."
Wow.
That's scary. I mean, you would have thought I was out there committing a revolution or, you know, trying to, I don't know, blow up the Pentagon or something, when all I was doing was pointing out that people who tell you that, you know, that people who make cursive into some kind of sacrament or some kind of 11th commandment do not have a factual basis. And there are times when I've given workshops and the occasional teacher has, you know, either screamed at me or has broken down and cried. Although fortunately, this does not happen. Within the past 4 months, I've done 2 workshops at NYU and they were very well received. But I get into a lot of this. In fact, I have actually, because of things I've pointed out, there actually have been bills to mandate cursive in this or that state legislature that literally dropped overnight from 99% approval rating to 0 approval rating, simply because I pointed out someone's misquoting facts, someone's misquoting the law of the land by saying signatures have to be in cursive. Legally, they could be anything. And someone, in one case, and I don't want to get into this, but in one state where people have been fighting to get a cursive mandate into their curriculum for, it must be 6-7 years at this point, I actually had pointed out that when the people in charge were showing up giving testimony, whether as legislators or just ordinary citizens, that some of them were printing out research reports, you know, research studies, and literally going through with whiteout and changing the words to make the studies be what they wanted.
Wow.
And you could find it because what they hadn't changed was the URL. You know, whoever legislator and got this, you know, sits at a meeting and things are passed out, doesn't go and check the URL. So I literally emailed every legislator and their legislator's assistant and said, look at what Senator so-and-so gave you this morning, and here's the URL, and look at this paragraph, this sentence, and look what it is, and look what she turned it into.
Wow.
Now, that same legislator, she was put out. Next year, she had a different document to alter. In fact, things got to such a point that at one point, the research she was misquoting was research from the state university of her state. And where this got really weird was she had misquoted that research basically to turn research that said handwriting eases the process of literacy into research that said cursive makes you smarter. She did this, and I would suggest that someone who does this is not showing a whole lot of brains.
Well, yeah, but I think that's an interesting point, because cursive has become almost synonymous with handwriting in a lot of the dialogue about handwriting. And so when people, when we discuss maybe not using cursive, people assume that we're talking about doing away with handwriting altogether.
Honestly, a lot of California schools, they don't even teach cursive anymore. I think, like, Riley, they still teach it, and that's about it. Like, I hear most places don't teach it. I hear they teach the printing now.
Whatever they do, and unfortunately, when they teach printing, they do a very poor job of teaching. It's very inefficient printing. But where this is scary is, one, there's still a lot of cursive out there. You know, you're going to work at some point for someone who writes in cursive, you know, or you're going to take a class with a professor who does. It's not really good employee-employer relations or student-teacher relations to have to go to your college professor or your boss and say, could you please write things, you know, not write things in cursive. Even if we did not have, you know, other people writing things in cursive, we might find old things. You know, what if you found your grandmother's love letters to your grandfather one day? You probably would want to read them, but what if you couldn't? Or just look at history. It would be very frightening for many Americans if we had a generation that could no longer read, you know, the very familiar looking handwritten copies of things like the Declaration of Independence.
Mm.
How would you know what it said? It would be theoretically possible if you had a society that, oh, I don't care about writing cursive, but if you could not read it, for someone to actually show you a handwritten copy of the Declaration when you were in school, and instead of letting you understand what it said, suppose you were in school in third grade and they had said, and here's the Declaration, and Thomas Jefferson wrote it, and it said that we must have an absolute monarch who is a dictator. In other words, they could presumably pull that. Now, fortunately, anyone who can read print can learn to read cursive. And the way I teach them is the way I was able to teach myself at age 24 to understand cursive and to write more legibly myself. I show them what I had to show myself, namely, how did cursive happen? How did we get from very, very understandable versions of letters like a capital J in your name or a capital G in my last name to these things that look like, you know, squiggles and spaghetti? It happens step by step. And if someone can read printing, you know, it takes about, depending on the person, 30 to 60 minutes to give them the keys to crack cursive. And then they can write cursive whether or not they read it, which is scary for the cursive lobbyist, because one of their cases that we should learn to read cursive is based on, well, if you don't learn to write it, how will you? Rather, one of their cases for why we must learn to write it, they would say, is, but if you don't write it, you can never, ever, ever learn to read it. Well, let's just say that I know six-year-olds that I have worked with who would laugh at that, because I taught them to read cursive, you know, as soon as they could read print, and, you know, they could go home and look on their mommy's refrigerator and look at a note she wrote and know what mommy was getting them for their birthday.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
and that's absolutely terrifying when you do it, as I have done it. I don't necessarily go and parade these children out and show them to the world, but they do a good job of that on their own here and there, wherever they exist. So I am only saying that, but the idea of equating cursive with equating handwriting with cursive, if you look at it, it's a scam. The idea, I'm not saying that cursive is a scam, but I'm saying that when it reaches the point where you take a specific style or brand name, what I mean is this: suppose there was a society in which the word protein was synonymous with the word clams, so that if the doctor said you need more protein in your diet, you would be told the only thing that has protein is clams, and you would have to go out and buy buckets of clams and eat them whether or not you were allergic. Well, that is basically what we've done. If you allow a specific term to be used as the general term, you're committing a disservice to people.
Right. That's definitely true.
Yeah. So there are people in my family who actually refer to what I do as my secret cursive war, my secret handwriting war, because it's just something that if I can do some good in the world, it seems to me that this is the avenue where I am most fitted to do some good in the world.
Okay.
I don't know, like a lot of the young people that I talk to, they just type the device. I don't even think they're worried about it. Like, yeah, they're just not.
We have a right to not be worried about it. I will say, however, that they're not the only people that, not everyone does this. If you look at those same cell phones, Apple, Samsung, you'll find that all of them have, within the past few years, added handwritten note-taking and messaging features into their built-in programs and into the increasing number of apps you can get. In fact, I was recently reading a blog by a professor who is at one of the colleges I went to, University of Pennsylvania, Jeffrey Nunberg, who is a very eminent linguist, and he now is a lecturer at Berkeley. And he points out that over the past 10 or so years of his teaching, he has pointed out that people in his classes were initially just typing everything, but now more and more are actually going back to taking more and more of their notes by hand because, and if you ask them why, they'll say, we remember it better if we write it by hand than if we're just pecking at a keyboard with one repetitive motion. We have the kinesthetic feedback. And the research backs them up. There have been research studies where college students were assigned to all go to the same lecture and take notes different ways. You know, some of them dictating into a tape recorder, perhaps, some of them typing, and some of them writing by hand. And then they tested them, and the ones who remembered most of the lecture had been the ones who had been randomly assigned to take handwritten notes. Now, and there have been numerous studies of this sort, which I'm aware of because going back to the fact of people misquoting studies, these studies typically get misquoted to claim that they were studies of people writing in cursive versus writing in printing versus keyboards, and only the cursive writers remembered everything. But again, you know, that's not true. As I found out when I looked up the studies, the handwriting doesn't have to be cursive to have an impact, but it does have this impact. And I will say that, you know, I have found it for myself, and so I think have some other people, that you do remember and compose a little differently if you're taking your notes by hand. It doesn't mean that handwriting is good, typewriters are bad, keyboards are bad. I think we need more than one means of input and output. And I would not want handwriting of some sort to disappear, if only because it's something that people try to do at an early age. In other words, you are more likely at an early age to want to pick up something and make a mark than you are to want to hit something with your finger over and over and over and over. And we've all seen the glee that children have drawing on the wall, let's say, or, you know, pretend writing. And I don't want that very ancient piece of the history of what human beings are when we sit down to communicate to completely disappear. And I say this as someone who is the biggest email junkie of all time, but I do use a lot of the handwritten features that are built into our communication systems. I have an iPhone, and I do use the handwritten message utility that's actually buried in there. And I have had a lot of the people, well, I've had the experience of a lot of the people who come to me are these techies. They're people 10, 15, 20, 25, 30 who want to know if they too could write by hand. A lot of them come to me and they say, I have a computer with, 100,000 beautiful fonts on it. And I am wondering, can fonts be done or simulated by hand? Can I do something equally good with my hands? And I tell them yes. And I tell them, in fact, most of the fonts out there are derived from some sort of handwritten original somewhere in the design process. So in a way, we are going, I think, full circle. I don't want to get pragmatic. Think about disasters. I have to tell you, one of my last jobs, working with hospitals, was actually in a hospital that I had to go to right after Hurricane Katrina. Right before Hurricane Katrina, this large hospital in Florida, right on the edges of the storm, had switched to electronic record keeping, which of course did not work during the hurricane. For 4 days, they had no power and they were operating by battery flashlights and taking notes by hand. And when they got their power back and they sat down and wanted to type all these accumulated pieces of paper into their computer system, once their computer system was back, they discovered that nobody could read those pieces of paper, including the doctors who wrote them. Now, disasters do not necessarily always happen. We don't have hurricanes going through every week, but that might change. We are in a world that is very precarious in many, many ways. Yeah. Remember that around the center of Hurricane Katrina, there were people who had no electricity for 6 months. That hurricane hit in August. In other words, right before the school year began, and many of the school districts in the area that was affected, believe it or not, they had just instituted computerized systems and had announced plans that, no more pencils, no more notebooks, it's all going to be computerized. And, well, you can imagine where those plans went. In fact, I have to tell you a funny story. When I went to that hospital where I had to work right after Hurricane Katrina, the hotel they sent me to did not have all of its power back. So even though they had an electronic check-in system, people were having to check in by writing in their names and everything by hand. And to do this, they'd had to actually call up a retired employee who'd been there since the 50s and find out, well, where did you keep your notebook, the ledger that we put away in the 70s when we went to, the first of our electronic systems. And, they had to find this retired guy and get him to tell them which drawer it was in and where was the key to that drawer.
Wow.
So this is something that, we may have disasters at any moment. It is great that we have electronics, but we are not guaranteed to always have them. I wonder if somewhere in the world there is maybe some shipwrecked sailor somewhere who can't figure out how to make an SOS in the sand. I hope for his sake that this is not the case. But I think that we need, since we all need at some point to write by hand, even ultra-modern computerized hospitals, believe me, they have people scribbling Post-its and sticking them on the walls of the nurse's station. Since we all need to write by hand sometimes, it should be legible, it should be rapid, it should stay legible at speed. And if you think of most of the things we write today are not any more things that we could necessarily go by guesswork if there's some illegibility. I mean, some things, yes. If I'm writing a handwritten thank you note to my mother to thank her for something, some nice present she sent me, if I happened to have a little error in my handwriting, she could figure out that the word was, you know, mittens or sweater or whatever. But most of the things that we write today, we have to write very quickly. They're brief things, but they're full of information. Think about how often you've had to jot down a telephone number, a website, an address or something, and you didn't necessarily want to pull out something electronic. You know, you had, you know, you were maybe at a conference, someone tells you their email address, you write it down on the edge of the conference brochure. Am I right?
Yeah, absolutely.
Right? I mean, how many times we don't always, even though, you know, even those of us who have little pocket recorders, you know, or have a watch with a recording function or have a cell phone where you can type on, we don't necessarily always pull these out. If you're in the middle of some casual, crowded environment, you know, you're just walking on, you know, you're in an elevator going from one floor to another, or you're walking to your hotel room and someone says, oh, I forgot to tell you they moved your conference room. You're not going to pull out your phone and like put in, now in the West Wing, room 310, 930. You're going to look for something that makes the mark. You're going to look for a pen or a pencil and scribble it on a piece of paper or on, you know, the sleeve of your jacket if you've got to.
Right.
And you know, and we tend to forget we do this. Sometimes I have challenged people who said, oh, I never write anything, it's just all electronic. I have challenged them to, I said, well, would you like to go through 24 hours not touching a pen, a pencil, not looking at anything handwritten? Would you like to do that in your workplace? And none of them have been able to do it. None of them has been able 100% to do that, even if they said, oh, we banished everything that wasn't electronic. Well, they didn't really. And given that we have to write somewhat, given that what we have to write is information dense, a lot of it is alphanumeric, you can't afford to have a 7 that looks like a 1, we cannot afford to have handwriting that gets sloppy at speed. But if you're not taught, and most people not only are not taught, but insofar as there are methods of teaching, a lot of the handwriting teaching that teachers used to get, such as it was, has not been required for about 50 years. If you have a kid in school, that kid is being taught the ABC by someone who learned the ABC, from someone who learned the ABC, from someone who really was not really taught right. Now, if we had this for arithmetic, you know, we know what would happen to the country, but this is precisely what would happen, what we have in handwriting. You know, if this happened in arithmetic, or if this happened in a foreign language class, imagine if you took Spanish and the person you had to learn Spanish from was someone who had been taught Spanish by someone who'd been taught Spanish by someone who'd been taught Spanish by someone who didn't know Spanish. You would raise a fuss. It would probably get on 2020. It would probably get on 60 Minutes. But when it comes to handwriting, people don't say boo, except for the people who say, well, what's wrong is it isn't in cursive. And I have to tell you, when I look at their cursive, I don't necessarily see wonderful, legible writing, you know, itself.
Julian, do we have any questions from the audience at this point?
I was looking and I don't have anybody commenting yet.
Okay. Yet. Have you shared it on Facebook and Twitter?
I did share it on Facebook and Twitter.
Okay. All right. Kate, I know you want to tell your personal story beyond handwriting. So at this point, if you want to merge over to that other aspect of your life.
Tell you, it's, let's just say that although my childhood was good in many ways, it was also bad in some rather unusual ways. I'm Jewish. My folks are Jewish. Like a lot of folks, you know, my parents were pretty well, you know, not believing Jews, not religious, not observant. Mm-hmm. But for some reason, they chose to send me to a school that was all the things they didn't believe in. That was a very religious Jewish school. And I was there for a couple of years before I was sent to a school that was very different and very much worse. I don't have time to go through, you know, my whole often problematic life. I mean, I'm 55 years and that's a lot of lifespan to talk about. But just to talk about my childhood, my parents knew very, very little about the religion and the culture that they wanted me to be familiar with, that they really had not had a chance themselves owing to circumstances of their own upbringing. So they sent me to a quite religious Jewish school. And when I came home, anything I brought home from school, you know, whether as a physical object or as, you know, something I'd learned that day, they did not believe in. And they were actually very, you know, they would basically tell me I was making things up and tell me, you know, don't talk about this. Decent people don't talk about religion, which they always, a word they always said in a very hushed voice as though it was like, you know, cancer or something.
Okay, can I ask you something about your parents? Were they American born? Were they,
yes, did they? They were, but their parents were not. And they were very much, you could say that they wanted to be 200% American, if you know what I mean.
Uh-huh, sure.
Yeah, and they did not have enough of a background to even know that a lot of the religious stuff continued. You know, they'd been brought up basically very secular in many ways, and they thought that basically what little they knew about was basically probably extinct. And so let's just say that it reached a point where I was actually, where one of the reasons that I was sent at a young age to a therapist was to cure me of what were considered to be my delusions. I'm not talking about delusions about that I had to do this, which is what people thought was the issue, but in other words, delusions that this even existed. In other words, if you wanted to use an analogy, it would be as if you had a child, you sent the child to a French immersion school, and when the child comes home speaking French, you tell the child that the child is speaking a made-up language which doesn't exist.
Okay, but see, that would be different from telling the child speak French at school and speak English at home, right?
Yeah, that would not have been acceptable to the school. That's where the analogy breaks down. That would be something you'd have at a French immersion school. But remember, when you are being brought up in a religion, you know, you don't bring someone up in a religion by saying practice your religion, you know, at school and not at home, when the home is what sent you to the school and the people at home are at least nominally in the same religion that they sent you to learn. Besides, let's just say it's not something that would work very well for someone like me. In other words, if you're going to tell me at school that people came from Adam and Eve and at home that people came from monkeys or whatever, you know, how does a 5 or 6 year old, how does it make sense to a 5 or 6 year old or even to a 55 year old me to say, how can you say, you know, people came from monkeys in my house and from Adam and Eve in the school? In other words, you can't.
But I mean, isn't
to contradict itself.
Yeah. But I mean, don't all of us have to, at a very early age, understand that not everybody believes the same thing?
Certainly. Right? That's certainly we do, but it didn't help the process to be told that what I could see being believed and practiced when I was in school was not being done, did not exist. No one ever did it. No one, in other words, it was not as if it was not so, it was not like knowing that there are different languages and different cultures in the world. It was like being sent every day to absorb a culture and a language that goes with it, and behaviors that go with it, and to be told, no, those never existed. And of course, at school, I was punished for accurately reporting what went on at home, and literally for begging my teachers and the principal on one hand, and my parents on the other hand, to please sit in a room together and come to some sort of agreement as to which sort of person they wanted me to be. One of the things that happened, you know, as a result, eventually I was taken out of a school and sent to what I can only describe as a chaotic hippie school. You know, the less said about that, the better. That was after 2 years in this Jewish school, and basically when I was being withdrawn, the principal met with me and my parents and basically said a few words of farewell and basically said, well, you know, well, little one, you're going to be living in this environment of this total apostasy with these parents who, you know, don't understand this. And what we're going to do is, it's your job really to do the whole Jewish thing in detail. Okay, I'm 7 years old. And it's your job to do it. And to make it possible, he told me, he gave me a Jewish calendar printed by a funeral home, which was the group that that printed them in those days, and said, you know, I've subscribed you to this. You're going to get this every year and simply do everything that's on there. Well, if you know anything about any form of traditional Judaism, it's not something you can do on a solitary basis. It's not something you can just sneak off and, you know, do in a corner someplace. I mean, I was responsible for doing the whole thing. And of course, at school, I'd been told earlier for the previous 2 years that I was responsible for doing it. And of course, since doing it required a family to do it around you, I was responsible for obtaining the compliance of my parents. And I was punished at school for failing to do so. And what made it worse was it was obviously we're bending the rules for some people. And they were very blatant that if people gave enough to the school or gave enough money to the school or gave enough money to the synagogue that ran the school, that, you know, they'd be cut some slack. I'd be told, and there was one instance, where there was some kind of Hebrew exam. And if you got a certain grade in it, I think 90 or above, you would get a prize and your name would be mentioned at the school assembly, and it would be wonderful. Well, I happened to be the best in my class at Hebrew, which was very annoying to them, because what right did I have with my background to be the best? And the person who was next under me, and, you know, the next best was someone. So I typically got like 90 or 95 or 99 on the test, and maybe 100. The person who did second best, I don't want to give her name because she's probably still alive, you know, we'll call her Bessie Teacher Pet or something, okay? Well, she, you know, she would get 80s or 85. But her daddy gave a lot to the school, and her daddy's name was on this building and that classroom, and he got all kinds of recognition. So at some point, when they were announcing who would get the prize for Hebrew in the second grade classroom for that year, they announced, well, Miss Gladstone got a 97. And as you know, the cutoff for getting the prize is 90. But Miss Gladstone will not get the prize, because the prize more deservingly goes to Miss Teacher Pet, who got an 82. And if only Miss Gladstone could persuade her parents to be better Jews, she might be worthy too of this honor.
So I have a question. This was a religious school, right? Was it a public religious school or a private religious school?
It's a private one. This is in the USA, and there are not public religious schools in the USA. It's not, as far as I know.
Okay, I was just trying to figure out. So they basically condoned that it was okay for students to tease a student who might not
In fact, that was true at that school and at other schools I attended at, you know, at the school that I was transferred to, and then the high school, you know, the school I was transferred to was public and non-religious. The high school I went to was, you know, no, the school I was transferred to was private and non-religious, and the high school was public and non-religious. But at those schools also, it was very common not only for children to bully and assault me verbally and occasionally otherwise, but in many instances for the teachers to urge this, and in some cases to require the other children to do it.
Okay, but not in every case. Not in every case it was about religion, right?
It could be in one instance, and this was not at the religious school, it was at the private school, it was that I had committed a great sin. I had spelled more words correctly during a spelling bee than anyone in the class, including the popular girls' clique, who were on my team. And although I had brought my team the victory, the popular girls clique complained, you know, that I could not be credited with this, that, you know, that it was just offensive to them. You know, how dare this rotten little person with bad handwriting and ugly buck teeth, which I had because I was a little too young for grace, and who didn't even, who transferred into the school just this year, just for third grade, instead of being in the school from kindergarten as the rest of us were. How dare she come into our school and, you know, spell better than us? And the teacher, well, went along with this partly because the young privileged ladies involved in the popular girls clique made it plain that if they, you know, that I was given a status equal with them as a student and as a human being, they would just disrupt educationally whatever was going on and would just raise riot and not allow education to continue. Part of course, what may have contributed to that was that the classroom I was in was at the moment in the middle of a fairly popular, at the time, exercise which was supposed to teach people not to be prejudiced. It was the exercise where you decide to show people what being prejudiced is like and how it's horrible by saying, okay, in the classroom we have students with blue eyes and students with brown or green eyes, and we'll decide that for a week the students with blue eyes are the best people and the others are like slaves. Ooh. And then we reverse it. If you want to look this up, Google brown eyes, blue eyes game when this is over. Oh, I would one of many, many.
Scary. That's horrible that they played this game.
Well, now it just so happened that everyone in the popular girls clique had blue or gray eyes. I had brown eyes. And of course, the school activities, including spelling bees, you know, were going on. During this, now, in fact, one of the things the popular girls resented was the possibility that when it came the day to switch, which group was the master race, or so to speak, that, oh my God, you know, we can't let her. And they hardly ever said my name. They always just her or something, actually it. We can't let it be above us, you know. So when the day came that they were going to switch who was on top, and the brown-eyed kids would get to be on top, the teacher, for me, made an exception. And for the week that the brown-eyed kids would be on top, she designated me to be an honorary blue eyes, although my eyes are brown.
That's insane.
Get this, so that the experiment, that's the teacher.
I can't believe this not is happening.
Could go on, we're saying. As far as I see, this is not teaching you that prejudice is wrong. This is teaching you, you know, the ancient age-old game of bigotry, and here's how to be a bigot, and here's what fun it is, and look what you can do, and look how wonderful you can feel if you pick a scapegoat. It actually reached the point that even though this experiment was only for 2 weeks, people who had been in that grade with me, right up until I left the school, which was at the end of ninth grade. It was a school that went up to high school, but I transferred out finally in ninth grade after things had reached a certain pitch, shall we say. There were still people who would walk by me on the stairs and they'd mutter as they passed me, "You filthy brown eyes," even if they had brown eyes themselves, just because they knew that it had made a dent on me. And what made it worse was that the teacher that year, and teachers and guidance counselors in subsequent years with whom I discussed it at the school, said, well, you know, you should really feel proud and honored that you were able to contribute in this way to the experiment, that you were able to bear the burden for them, to be their sacrifice so that their self-actualization could progress. And I would ask, you know, what about my self-actualization? And I'd be told I was being, you know, too selfish, really expecting too much of others.
Okay.
Wow. All right. So if you want to know how to make someone have huge problems that nobody knows how to deal with when those problems are brought into therapy or counseling. Let's just say I have a lot of problems in my life, but these are, you know, these contributed to, let's just say that the handwriting and what happened at various schools, these were all contributory factors. And let us just say I have not found any very effective therapy. Some therapists have been able to help me a little bit with some of the smaller things, but it was often at the cost of the bigger things getting worse or simply not been dealt with. And I've had therapists who have told me, why couldn't you just have, you know, normal problems? If you were going to have religious problems, why couldn't you have the usual one of your parents being in the cult and bringing you up in the cult?
Would just stop going to therapy, because I don't think therapists are that helpful, honestly.
Well,
just
I did eventually, you know, I would go and see them. However, equally often it was that the therapist kicked me out. Sometimes they said, I can't take your money because I really don't know what to do for you. You don't have anything that my recipe book as a therapist, someone said, tells me how to handle. In one case, the therapist referred me to someone very, very far away that I would never be able to get to. And he said, not that I think he's going to be helpful to you, but I just don't want you around here. In two cases, there were actually therapists who said, normally I would refer someone like you to a colleague of mine, but frankly, I don't know any colleagues that I hate enough to dump someone like you and problems like yours onto them.
Well,
in other words, I wasn't the problem that you had how to handle. I wasn't, you know, a rape survivor. I wasn't a drug addict. I wasn't, you know, I wasn't any of the many popular sort of problems, you know.
Yes, but I mean, don't you
at
think?
At one point, there was one therapist who said, Kate, it's too bad you're not a lesbian, because if you were, you could be in a gay and lesbian support group and they would be understood, but you're not. And I said, well, like, do you want me to be? Like, am I supposed to go and try to get some lesbian to pick me up and do some lesbian thing with them? Because I have no interest in that. I'm not saying one thing or another about that issue, other than that it is not my issue. At one point, I was referred, for instance, to a Jewish survivor of abuse support group. And I thought, oh, at last. Turned out it was specifically a group for people who'd been raped by their rabbis or Hebrew school teachers.
Oh, good.
Much like those who now with Catholics. Well, that wasn't my issue. They'd done a lot of things to me, but holding me down and raping me wasn't one of them. And I said, you know, you sure I belong here? Well, maybe they understand difficult stuff. Maybe you should be shoehorned in. And I went there, and of course I told my story, and said, no, you've been referred here by mistake. You know, you don't have our issue. And
Kate,
I went back.
Don't you think that really what the issue is, it's not the Jewish thing, and it's not the handwriting thing necessarily. It's the fact that you're very logical. In other words, the Aspie's symptoms were what got you in trouble.
College, I was actually kicked out of a logicians club for being, according to the club president, too logical.
Okay, too logical.
I don't know how logical he was, because, well, one of my other issues at college was I'm allergic to most of the stuff that college people do for fun. I'm allergic to marijuana. I don't respond well to alcohol, and I have a serious allergy to tobacco. Which actually I've known all my life.
And that's fine.
I knew it before I was born, because my mom used to smoke. And basically the first way she knew she was pregnant was she could no longer stand cigarettes. And the minute I was born, she craved them again. Well, anyway, I actually persuaded my parents to quit smoking by basically just being sick around them. So they gave up when I was about 4 or 5, just because I couldn't. Just because the stuff, I mean, I can be in a room where someone was smoking 30 minutes ago, 30 feet away, and it's smoking or toking, and it's no good. Well, anyway, at the Logic Club, one of the things that had gone on was, well, I remember instances of the club president, the club vice president, sitting around basically toking before the meetings, are like, yo, Howard, like, existence, like, it exists, man. Oh, Frank, you said that last week. I know, but I just, like, just, integrated it. Could I have another brownie? So I didn't really fit in, because if you're too logical for the logic club that's run by a couple of stoners, and you can't be a stoner because it makes you allergic, all I can say is I hope I never get any of those diseases that are now treated with cannabis, because I wouldn't want to be allergic to something that's supposed to get me better.
Yeah, well, hopefully you won't get those.
Things like rock music, it's just too crazy, just dissonant, crazy loud. You could say I'm allergic to that too. So going through college, and if you can't drink, can't smoke, can't toke, can't, you know, go to the hear the same music everyone else is.
I didn't do any of those things in college. I didn't drink, I didn't smoke, I didn't hang out with a lot of groups. It's fine. It's okay.
But fine. It was fine. Maybe it's fine. But the point was, I was considered to be a bit abnormal in that if some guy wanted to date me, his idea would be like, hey, we could go to this bar and then we could go to the rock concert. And I'd be, no, you know, because he might as well have said, hey, let's have a good time and go out and I'll zap electricity into your ears for 3 hours straight.
Yeah.
You know? And the problem was, you know, it was not necessary. I mean, there were quieter people, but they didn't understand me for other reasons. And when I talk about at college at one point, I was referred to a network for like ex-cult survivors. They said, oh, maybe it's the same problem as yours. Turned out that these were people who'd grown up in Christian-based cults and escaped. Not my issue. At one point, when I joined the synagogue, I was referred to like the support group for people who were intermarried, like Jews who married Catholics or Muslims or whatever. And nope, they didn't want to
like.
Wasn't my issue. Wasn't my
issue. Like, constantly,
I would kept being told, "Why can't you have the issues that are on our agenda?"
That's why I don't think therapy is always the answer. Because look at the history of therapy. Look at all the things they've done to people. I don't think therapists know all the time, and that's just my opinion.
I wouldn't have minded working with a therapist who is willing to learn. But if a therapist, you know, is going to say, you know, you have all these issues and I didn't learn about any one of them, and that will be $130. Well, at a certain point, you know, when that doesn't work out. And at a certain point, you know, you could get relaxation tips, meditation tips. I have trouble with a lot of that too. It annoys therapists when they tell you something and it doesn't work quite the way they think it will. And very, very few things that I've had to do for therapy or for whatever have worked. I don't know at this stage what would work. I will tell you that my experiences have left me, I would say people talk about being triggered, and I'm actually triggered by a lot of Jewish things. For part of my life, I thought, well, I'll get away from my parents, and then if I want to do all the Jewish stuff, or some of it, I can do it. And then I found I couldn't. Early in my marriage to my darling husband, who is a very sweet and understanding man who loves me very much, you know, I said, look, I'm going to grit my teeth. I'm going to try to do some Jewish things, light candles on Friday night. And I couldn't do it. And I just sat there crying. And I said, no, I cannot have this. I cannot have Jewish practice in the house, because I don't want this household, especially if we ever have children, which we never did, but I don't want this household to be a place where Friday night becomes, you know, the night where, you know, the woman of the house freaks out and cries and screams and can't stand it.
Yeah, well, do you think that maybe your parents wanted to, they just wanted the identity, but they just didn't want the religion?
I don't know about that, because when I asked them about it, my father is deceased, but when I asked him during his lifetime, and when I asked, and at times when I asked my mom, who is in her 80s and is now very sad for a lot of the things she's done, but heck, the damage is done, they don't really know what they wanted. They, you know, they don't think it was quite wanting the identity, quite wanting. It's as if they didn't know enough about the subject to know what they wanted. And frankly, it didn't interest them. They thought they knew enough. to return to the language example, well, if Hebrew school was something like being in French immersion, or even like being moved to Paris, let's say, you know, imagine if the people who wanted you to learn French and thought it was a super duper thing to learn French, thought they knew French, but the French they knew was French baby talk because their parents had known a few words of French having French parents. So imagine if your mother's idea of French, of speaking French, is like the French equivalent of me no want a ducky wucky. And you come home and saying me no want a ducky wucky, you're speaking French. You know, you're saying like I don't like fried duck, thank you, or whatever. You know, imagine. In other words, many times, you know, I was punished very much, sometimes even for asking, well, specify, please, mom, dad, can you specify what it is you do want? And then maybe you could find some way to go along with it. If they had said, okay, we're going to be total atheists, I would have said, okay, we'll do that. If they'd said, we're going to go the whole Jewish trip 100%. Or if they'd said, we're going to do this, but not that, this, but not that. You know, I would have gone along if they could have specified. I would have followed any house rules if there had been house rules. And I was punished at home literally for saying, could you kindly tell me what percent Jewish you want me to be?
Which that's a very asking question, though. That's a very,
how do you define
me? It's just a human question.
No. I think what it is that most humans do not say, what percentage do you want me to be of X and what percentage? It's only somebody very logical who would say that.
To the extent that she did say anything, she would change her mind. For instance, you know, it might be that 1 year, we might have a Seder, 1 year we might not have a Seder. And you know, and it was just random. Also, she did have, I would not say that she was bipolar, is bipolar, because I don't diagnose people, and she would be outraged. Fortunately, she's unlikely to be listening to this, you know. She, you know, because she does not like go on this stuff a lot. If she does, I'll never live it down. So I don't know what I'm even doing talking. But there were times
I'll tell you what, my mom's definitely.
She would say something and forget it. Many people, you know, there were times when she would give an order and forget it. It might be an order to do something, to not do something. Mm-hmm. There were times when she told me to go to my room and she would, until I was called down, and she'd forget to call me down. And then she'd be angry that I was showing up late for dinner and hadn't shown up until I was called down. There was at least one time when I brought home something from Hebrew school. It was, I don't know, something I was supposed to do with my family. Apparently, we were supposed to take pictures, like get your mom and dad to take photos of you all sitting in the family sukkah together and bring them in for a class display on Sukkot. Okay, which you might have to explain to the non-Jewish people who may be watching this. And well, I knew already that she wasn't going to cooperate with this. So I did the best I could. I had this, you know, this worksheet with little blanks where photographs were supposed to go. And I drew, you know, little pictures, little stick figures of what was supposed to happen but wasn't happening. And my mom found this and said something like, why are you drawing on your schoolwork? She couldn't read the schoolwork. It wasn't Hebrew, but she could see I'd drawn something. She said, oh, we were supposed to draw something. Not knowing what to say, we were supposed to bring, I said, like, we were supposed to bring in pictures, you know, pictures. And so these are my pictures. And she was okay with it that time, because sometimes randomly, capriciously, she'd be okay. So, of course, I brought it in. And, of course, I, you know, got a zero. And, of course, I asked her, I tried to explain, but my teachers wouldn't believe that I, you know, they wouldn't.
Feel like it's your parents' fault. Like, they're wanting you to go to this religious school, but they're not wanting to be religious, and they're not.
I would say if they'd made up their mind, you know, I wouldn't have cared if they'd wanted me to be, I don't know, to believe in Japanese Buddhism or something, mm-hmm. or Islam. You know, all I tried to say was if you pick something and if you put me in there, you can't put me in a place where the whole experience is going to be fragmented and expect me not to come out of it with the consequences of that. And I was told, well, we do, you know, a normal person can deal with this. Now, I don't know how much of this is specifically Aspie and how much of this is how anyone might have responded. But I will tell you the very, because there were times when my mom stuck up for me, but it was ineffectual. You know, it was yet another time I was bullied, you know, by a teacher. There was one thing that really hit home for mom, not so much in terms of thinking that, well, partly in terms of thinking that, yes, something was wrong with me, but one of the few times that I think she thought, yes, something must be wrong with the school. And it was not at the Jewish school. It was at the one after that, which I would call the politically correctitudinous hippie school. Mm-hmm. You know, and that's the best one. Which she had picked out because it was the school for gifted children and had quite easily passed the test. And it was supposed to be very low pressure. So she said, well, maybe this will counteract what they did to her, you know. Well, anyway, at one point in that school, somewhere in the middle of third grade, you know, we had typically some kind of class. I forget what it was, but it was something we went to every like Wednesday after lunch in the seventh floor auditorium. There was a seventh floor auditorium and an eighth floor auditorium. And we were told, and we'd be told typically, well, after you come in from recess and, you know, and you get in the building, just make your way quietly to the seventh floor auditorium. Well, one day the teacher happened to say, after you come in from recess, go to the eighth floor auditorium. And I went up there, and you know, no one else was there. And it turned out she had a slip of the tongue.
Sure.
She meant the seventh floor, but as anyone might, she had a little slip of the tongue. Everyone else had just heard what they expected to hear and had gone in after recess, you know, gone to the restroom, whatever, gone to the correct place. And I was sitting up there and no one could figure out where I was for an hour and a half. Anyway, when I came home and told my parents about this, they just didn't want to leave it. But they knew me well enough that they said, well, let's look into it. You know, we've got to see what's going on. And they went in and they met with the teacher. I was there in the room. My mom was there. My dad was there. The teacher was there. And they said, well, you know, our daughter is saying, you know, she's basically swearing on the Bible that today you said 8-4, but no one was there. And she went there because you said 8-4, although usually the 7th, and she can't figure out what's going on. What's going on? And the teacher said, yes, today I really did. I did really have a slip of the tongue yesterday, and I did say 8-4, but something's wrong with your daughter if she acted on that. No other child made that mistake of setting aside their prior knowledge. No other child made the mistake. They all interpreted 8th properly as 7.
Yeah, that happens because what the other children are doing is they're engaged in mind reading. You know, the normal.
I know. I have to tell you, I have good friends who are into things like, you know, ESP and so on. Which I'm not going to say one word or another about the possibility of whether it exists. But all I can say is that if the human race has a gift of mind reading, ESP, telepathy, call it what you like, I do not have this. If you say,
I know.
For me, 8 is 7 plus 1. 8 is not 7. Well, you can bet after that, I didn't even trust math class.
I like it when people are direct with me. Like if I usually am direct, I don't get hints and people get mad at me and I'm like, well, I don't get a hint. Like, just be direct. And if you say something, I go off that. So I don't think you did anything wrong.
Well, no, I had the same experience. I literally experienced.
Everyone else. And this was actually brought up to me in class by the teacher and by the students after this. You know, everyone else has a sort of human intuition where when the wrong thing is said or when the wrong instruction is given, they can still make it right. At one point, someone quoted to me, I forget who it was. I don't think it was a student, but it might have been one of the teacher's aides. There's a Brazilian proverb that you have to draw straight with crooked lines. In other words, if someone gives you a crooked ruler, you still have to know how to make the straight line. And I didn't. If you give a crooked ruler and you tell me to trace along that ruler, I will bloody well trace along that ruler. If you tell me 7, I'll believe 7. If you tell me 8, I'll believe 8. I don't know how I'm supposed to listen to 8 and get the number 7, or listen to 7 and get the number 8, whichever it was.
Yeah.
I have to tell you, and when Facebook came around, I actually, wanted to get in touch with some of my old, classmates from whatever schools. And I basically would find whoever I could trace by their name, And I sent a message, and it was just very noncommittal, just my name, basically. And hi, I'm so-and-so. Remember me from blank, blank school, blank, blank grade. And 1/3 of the people who I sent this message to never responded. And 1/3 of them basically said things like, oh, my God, seeing you get bullied determined the course of my life. One of my worst tormentors, for instance, grew up and became a Christian minister who's in the ministry that works with survivors of bullying and assault, because it's like his way of trying to repent for what he did to me. Mm-hmm. But about 1/3 of them, but a lot of them, a lot of the ones who said, who sorrowed for me actually said, we went along and we were innocent bystanders because it was clear that if we spoke up or moved a hand or foot, it was clear to us we would be next. But 1/3 of them said, oh, that must have been such a great experience for you, Kate. I bet it's like so built up your character and made you a wonderful person. No. Okay, if you think that this is what makes someone a wonderful person, you'd be, doing it to everyone. It would be in the curriculum, 13 credit hours of torture a week or something. But that wasn't there for everyone.
No.
Bullying's wrong. I mean, it's really sad that a teacher would encourage students to do that.
In some cases, it was more than encouragement. It was required. Also, there were times when school assignments were such that I could not honestly do them. I remember we had to write assignments with one name like, why childhood is a joyful time. Or in one case, we had to write something like, describe your 3 best friends and what you like best about each one and what they like best about you. And I didn't have one friend, let alone 3 of my best ones. And I wrote about how, I only wrote like 2 sentences. I cannot do this for this assignment. I am required to have 3 friends and I haven't 1. And this was not acceptable. Because I wasn't even trying if I gave that back.
Yeah.
All I want to know is what should I have done growing up? How could I have earned a proper upbringing out of them? What should I have done to arrange my environment so that my environment would not be detrimental to me? Because I failed to do it. I do not like to be someone who is manhandled by the environment. And I feel like someone who has been made really almost into a subhuman, whether I wanted to or not, no matter what I tried. I feel that huge parts of me are missing and that in some way, somehow, I will be accountable for not having those parts.
What part do you think is missing? I mean, what part do
you... I don't know. It's so missing that I don't even know what it would be.
Well, you're probably not missing anything. You're a human being.
Yeah, you're alive and you have a nice husband. And I think that you have an interesting life, who cares about those people? They were bad people. I would just forget them.
About them because the influence less. And interesting is the least of it. What's said to be, I don't know if it's true, but what's said to be the greatest curse in the Chinese language, I'm told, is may you live in interesting times. I don't know if this is true. I don't know more than a few words of Chinese, but I could have done with a less interesting life that was not an assault. I didn't like being put into situations where I was basically told that my being assaulted was right and good and for the good of others, and I should be happy that they were benefiting and self-actualizing and all the rest of it.
Well, I mean, that was garbage, of course.
Yeah.
Why was it done? Why was this even legal? It wouldn't be legal to burn a child alive. It wouldn't be legal to rape a child. It wouldn't be legal to take a child and you know, remove parts of its brains. And if you look at the research now on complex post-traumatic stress syndrome, on adverse child experiences, you'll find that they're finding that prolonged stress, isolation, ostracism, trauma actually has a physical effect on the brain that is similar to, you know, that basically is on a par with two specific parts of the brain. Why did I have to have this on top of, you know, whatever came with the package? Why?
Well, I mean, it wasn't design. It was not like a divine design. It was an accident that happened.
I don't know. I wouldn't call it a divine design, but I sometimes wonder if it wasn't humanly designed. Given that it meshed so neatly with what others wanted and with what others said was good for the others about whom they
I think it's just group dynamics, and some groups have really bad actors, and you were in some really bad schools. I'm sorry, but I would hope nowadays that wouldn't happen, because I think with social media, this wouldn't happen nowadays, because the kid could get on their phone and tweet. Like, I would hope nowadays that nobody would do anything like this.
Google the word cyberbullying, C-Y-B-E-R bullying. It does happen, and I know people it happened to, and there are some people that I would like to know to whom it had happened to, but I cannot know them because they committed suicide. And I was actually very close to committing suicide a few times from the age of 9 on over various issues.
Mm-hmm.
If my mom is listening, this will be the first that she knew about it. I didn't want her to know. But let's just say that I don't think that social media make it easier. You just go Google cyberbullying and start reading. Tell me social media made it easier.
I've been cyberbullied, but in my case, I choose those people want to spend their time trying to bring me down. I'm not going to let them do it. It's my choice. Like, I just decided.
What if your cyberbully was the teacher? What if your cyberbully was a sibling or someone that you had to work with on a class project? Or something of that sort. What if the only way to avoid your cyberbully, you know, and I'm glad I didn't have to face this problem growing up, but what if the only way to avoid your cyberbully was to not communicate electronically with anyone, because once they knew where you were on the internet, they would always come after you?
Well, honestly, I would hope now in this environment, knowing about bullying, I think there is a way to remedy this to where children would be treated this way in the future. That's what I believe.
Maybe. I'm not living in the future. I'm not living in that future, and I never was. To my personal knowledge, some of the worst instances of bullying happen when the school group is on their way out of having taken the pledge not to bully. And it just
No, I don't like those pledges. I mean, I was bullied to a certain extent, not to the extent that you were, but to a certain extent during my life. And my daughter was in school, and they were taking those pledges, and she and I talked about it, and we realized that those pledges are not doing anything to help people.
Part of the problem is even the word bully. It is too gentle a word. If you look up, it's actually a euphemism. If you look up where the word came from, it used to be actually a slang phrase for a good friend. It's not bullying. It's assault. It's torture. If this happened to an adult, you know, bullying, you know, is too gentle a word. So if its connotations are positive, think of Teddy Roosevelt's bully pulpit. Think of, I would say, you know, if we wanted to end the problem, we would be we would be calling it what it is, assault and torture and other things that are less nameable in public.
Yeah. And I don't really think it will ever completely disappear, because it seems to be a part of human nature.
It is to some degree, yes. I just think, well, we can choose how we react to it as well. We can choose, like, okay, I had bad experiences when I was a kid, but I'm not going to let those experiences define my life. Like, I want to do things I enjoy. I had people throw things on me, hit me with objects in class. I'm not kidding. I had kids kick me. And I'm not going to let those people, like, I wouldn't let those people control my life. That's all.
Whatever you do, look, I made the same resolution, but that doesn't mean I could enact it. In other words, you can, certainly you can try to grit your teeth and grin and bear it, which I was always asked to do by my bullies, my assaulters, the ones who, you know, well, who pushed me down. Well, normally it was verbally, sometimes otherwise. They would say, well, you've got to maintain a cheerful attitude while we're doing this to you.
Well, I'm not talking about at the time. I'm talking about, like, as years go by, we don't know.
I've tried. Do you think I have not tried? Do you think I don't get up every day and resolve?
I'm just trying to share my viewpoint, like a different viewpoint. That was all.
Please go ahead, Pat.
No, it's okay. I decided by the time I was 20, because I had some pretty severe bullying experiences, but I talked to a friend and she's like, I don't understand. Like, why do you still feel this deeply about certain things? And that just registered in my mind at that point. Like, why would I still be giving power to these people at this point in my life? Like, I just have decided in my adult life, okay, I'm not going to fit in with certain groups. Not everybody's going to be my best friend, but that doesn't keep me from doing things that we enjoy, like I and I doing live streams, working on art projects. Like, there's so much in life to live for. I'm not going to let a few bad experiences from my childhood define who I am. That's just my view.
It doesn't work. That's not the issue, whether they define who I am. The issue is that I could not conquer it and overcome it no matter how I tried. A human being ought to be able to do this. The issue is that I believe that there was something about me. Why would I be picked on? Why would I be the child who, when attack was put on my seat and I sat on it, was forbidden by the teacher to stand up? Why was I the one who was literally called, sometimes by teachers, a non-human in public? In other words, it's not a matter of giving them power. They had a power that I could not take away from it. Something was different about them, and something that might be the result of a disability on my part, might not, but even so, you know, maintaining an attitude of optimism, as you so valiantly do, is working very well for you, and is something that I have tried and have been ordered to try literally every day since I was 5 years old. And after I was not ordered externally, I tried to order myself to do it, and it does not work. I would say that it works maybe 10% as well for me as it plainly does for you. And I'm not putting it down. I'm so glad that this works well for you, because it
also works. Yeah, I don't feel like it's a put down at all.
This is one reason I am ashamed of myself.
Okay, well, that's...
It does not work well for me.
Here's what I have to say. My feeling about bullying is that it's not really... It's not the fault of the person who gets bullied. It is something that is wrong with the bullies. And in most cases, it's not just that they think that this person is less than they are. Usually they feel envy because they realize that this person has something that they don't have. And in your case, it was intelligence. Okay? You were obviously much more intelligent.
There are other ways in which I was and am objectively less. I was bullied for, you know, I was bullied for having bad skin, which is certainly nothing to envy. I was bullied for things that really are problems that really are not good. I do not think that overall it was, I do not think that overall it was envy. And if it was envy, in a way that makes it worse, in a way that makes it worse, because it's like saying, with all my good qualities, I couldn't even count as an equal.
Well, I mean, equality is certainly overrated, you know, it's certainly if we, none of us are equal to each other. Everybody's got, you know, points where they're way above everybody else and other areas where they might be way below. And we can't be equal. We can't be the same, you know, and the whole idea that we have to be.
True, but I was under orders to be equal, to be at least equal. And I was under orders to be at least equal in my worst areas. And then I might perhaps have been permitted to be up there to be better than equal in my best areas. But I never did. I never achieved that. I never got as far as even being considered a person.
But you are a person and you've contributed a lot. So I think, I guess my question is, like, now, like, at this point in your life, like, how do you feel about that experience? Like, from this point on, like, how do you feel it ties in with your research and things like that?
I believe how it ties in, I would say, is that I was treated like dirt for things that were beyond my control, and that it was irrational to treat someone dirt over. There were times when, for instance, I was told late.
Sorry.
Well, I just want to wait. Oh, thank you. There were times when I was told that I could not possibly have done as well as I had just done on some assignment or some oral presentation, because no one with that crummy, slow, illegible handwriting could possibly have done that well. I was obviously too stupid to have done that well, but if I was that stupid, I was obviously too stupid to cheat. So they didn't know what to make. Like, it was like, yeah, we have to give you a 98 on this paper or 100 on this paper, but we don't have to believe that we really should.
Well, I think that is an example of envy. They think that unless you can do the basic stuff they can do with handwriting or whatever, cursive, then it's not possible for you to be much more intelligent than they are. That's envy. That's what it is. And
it might be envy, but I don't understand. If it's envy, then envy is something I don't understand. Surely to see something done well is something to celebrate, not something to want to destroy.
Well, I agree. But I think the remedy to that is not necessarily having instruction in the schools about how not to bully, but allowing people to excel in the areas that they excel, and understanding that you don't have to be excellent at everything to be excellent at something.
But how do we make it happen? After all, the school where this happened the most, the politically correctitudinous hippie school, claimed to be entirely about that. That's why I had been sent there. In other words, they didn't have any anti-bullying programs. This was, you know, the 70s. They didn't have that. Nothing was done to the bullies.
I don't even think it has to be like
anti-bullying self-esteem.
Bullying program. Like, personally, I don't agree with that. I just feel like
neither do I. But what could have been done?
Well, I'll tell you what was done for me, Kate. At 13, I was bullied. So my parents took me out of school and I studied at home for 3 years and then I went to college. So that's one thing you can do.
Good for you. And it might have worked if my only parent had been my father, who was much more gentle as a man than my mother was. But I have to say that my mother was one of the bullies. So for me, it would not have worked.
Okay.
Yeah. And I will tell you, my mother had not started out necessarily being a bully, but she was in a situation she didn't know how to deal with. And when I pointed this out at school, you know, I was told, well, you know, she'll have to learn. You'll have to motivate her to learn. I learned early, I am not, as a person, I don't have the charisma. I'm not capable of motivating people. As a five-year-old, I didn't have what it takes to do what I, as a five-year-old, was required to do for a 35-year-old, my mother, and a 37-year-old, my father. I didn't have what it takes to influence others, and it was plain that I did not have it. No, I do not know if there is a God or anything of that sort in the world at all. But if I die and I find out that there is, I fully expect to be condemned. I fully expect that I will, you know, be told that there was something I failed to accomplish and that it doesn't matter that I couldn't, I failed, and it's just going to be too bad.
Well, you're making your God in the image of the people that you've met on this.
I don't intend to. I hope very much that I am wrong, but I have to face the possibility that I may be right. I hope I'm wrong. I hope I'm wrong in that God, so to speak, lives up to his advertising. But remember, I have seen so many beautiful sounding things that did not live up to their advertising. You know, I've seen so many places and people that talked about, we're all about freedom, we're all about self-actualization, we're all about recognizing that everyone is different and has different strengths and weaknesses. But when the pedal hit the metal, you know, that wasn't what was there beneath the surface.
I think part of the problem is that if you have a normie parent, and it sounds like your mother was very much a normie, it's just really hard to explain to them that they have to use logic and reason to communicate with you instead of...
She's very logical, but she rather suspected it. What I know about my mom is that in some ways she's very much like me, but she sees it as undesirable and she doesn't, you know, she doesn't like those parts of herself. You know, she'll use logic when she has to, and she'll use reason when she has to. And she can be very smart. I mean, she's not the kind who couldn't balance a checkbook because she's like thinking about unicorns or something. You know, she's not that, you know. She is the kind who can sit down and she has to solve a problem with logic, you know, do her taxes or handle something realistic, she can. But she also has this ability that she can't understand any human being lacking, which I suppose is this mind-reading ability to just know just what's meant to be done. And understand how one can lack it, how... If someone is speaking to me and cannot find a word for something and says, Kate, could you go get me the... Well, I'm helpless. And my father and my mother both had this little bit of word-finding difficulty where they, you know, they wouldn't have the nouns or certain nouns in the sentence. There would be blanks, not always at the end. There were times when my dad, for instance, would say, okay, honey, you know, let's go and get your, and we can go to the, but I can't do anything with that. And they wouldn't understand, you know, why would everyone else know what was meant most of the time And I wouldn't know, and I'd say, you know, please, mommy, what goes in the blank? You know, please, daddy, get my what?
Yeah.
Is there something different that I could have known that would have made me intelligible to my own parents?
But, you know, I mean, if they had been sort of coached on the issue of mind reading and how some people are not as good at it as other people, then don't you think that your parents would then have been able to understand better why you couldn't fill in those blanks?
They knew very well. They had, I believe they understand the issue well from having talked with my mother and from having talked with my father before he passed on. They understood very well that there was, that here there was someone who did not hear what was not being said, who could not hear between the lines or read between the lines. They understood, and they could have told you, I think, in as good detail as the best clinician of autism. The problem was that they said, as they said about anything where I was unable, well, you just have to be able. We don't know how to tell you how to get there, but it's a fact of life that you have to have this missing ability or you won't be able to function in so much of the world that is out there. And this is cryingly necessary, and you don't have it and you've got it.
Well, do you think that over the years, you have gotten a little bit better at mind reading?
I don't really think so, or if I have, not enough. If you imagine the ocean, and if you imagine adding one drop of sweet water to an ocean of salty water, a little bit better. It's not enough. They, you know, in other words, I could, if I've gotten better, I've gotten a drop better, and we're talking about, you know, cubic megaliters better than I would have to be.
Yeah, I understand.
It's not enough to make a difference. I don't know if I could get to that level if I could live for a billion years. I don't know. In other words, I might get better, but it's not enough better given the, you know, extreme amount of this ability of mind reading that is supposed to come with the package that you're supposed to have as a baby, even.
Mm-hmm. Although, yeah. If everybody's so good at mind reading, wouldn't we all win the lottery? Wouldn't we all know everybody's intentions? So I think everybody has a little bit of not being able to know everybody's intentions, like to some degree.
Yeah, but the problem is that I have a lot of it, and I have it in circumstances where others don't. In other words, there are times when things look ambiguous to me that also look ambiguous to others. But there are other times when it doesn't, you know. It's like saying you could say that everybody, if you think of the difference in mind reading ability as like the difference in people's heights, some people are 5'5", 6'6", you know, the occasional 7-footer or the occasional 4-footer. You could have all those people together in a room at a cocktail party, and they all have different degrees of tallness or shortness. But if there's someone in the room who's 6 inches high, it won't matter that there's someone else who's short in the room. There's almost as big a gap between the 6-inch high person and the 4'4" person. You know, there's a much bigger gap between the 6-inch high midget in the, well, very tiny Lilliputian, and the 4'4" rather short statured person. That's a much bigger gaps in between the 4'4" person and the 6'6" person.
Mm-hmm. But you found a husband who loves you.
He's also on the autism spectrum, I should tell you.
Yeah?
He is, in fact, he probably is more so than I am in some ways, less so than others. yes, I found him, but I didn't find him till I was 30 something. I was 30. He was 41.
That's fine. That's great, actually. Fine. You're lucky. Fine. Believe me. You're very lucky.
But on the other hand, you know, nobody lives forever. You know, he's going to be gone sometime. I hope, but, you know, not too soon. But let us just say that there are very few people in the world that I can get along with. You know, and the first one I found who was marriageable was the first friend I ever made, and I married him. And the person before that who somewhat understood me was my father, and he's gone, you know? And he understood me most ways, except that it did take me, I would say, 40-some-odd years to convince him that Hebrew school that I'd been through had been real, you know? And when I did, he was apologetic. And my mother was very apologetic for things she did. So my dad understood me a lot. And my husband understands me a lot. But there are probably very few other people.
You know, there's a lot of really outgoing, charismatic people that might be good at mind reading. And they're single. They're in their 40s like me. They haven't met somebody. So I think you're doing pretty good in an area where a lot of people aren't. So you know what? I mean, that's great.
I'm glad you think so. I just think it is great. But there could have been a lot more. I would very much have appreciated having been reared as a human being. I would very much have appreciated not having been subjected to what I was subjected to. I believe that I've lost some things by it that I would be better off if I had not lost them. And I feel very short-changed. Nice as things have been, they could have been nicer. And I had to go through a lot to get, you know, to where I am. And I believe that I have what I would like to have, but I had to pay much too high a price to have it.
I understand.
Yeah. But it's good that you have what you have and that you didn't let all of this destroy everything that's good that's inside you.
Maybe, although I wonder if a lot of it was destroyed, and I just don't really know.
Well, do you like, okay, I know you like handwriting, but do you have like any hobbies or anything that kind of are interesting that you would like to share with us?
What is known as loom knitting, which is also known as peg knitting. It's knitting with basically a kit that has separate pegs, not needles. I do calligraphy, which you might expect from my handwriting hobby. At one point, I used to compose a lot of what are known as filk songs, science fiction music. The sad thing about that is that one day I was interrupted in the middle of doing one, and it was an interruption that I could not get rid of for an hour or two. And when I returned to where I was in the song, I literally found that I could no longer compose, and I have not been able to from that day to this. It was just, let's just say it's complicated. It was a very traumatic interruption. I don't do well being interrupted. And it was the kind of thing for where you're interrupted for an hour and then other things happen during that hour and other things. And when I got back to it, I just found that, you know, my muse or whatever had just gone AWOL and nothing could entice her back.
But you've been making some kind of jewelry that shows people's initials.
That's
cool.
Those haven't sold too well. I do them in cooperation with a 3D printing hobbyist who works through a company called Shapeways. And what he does is he produces these in various materials to my design. And what they are 3D pendants. You can get them in you know, brass or plastic or steel or even really high-end metals like gold or rhodium. And what they are, just letters in my handwriting, and you get three letters per pendant, and the pendants are computer designed so that they, so that, let's say the initials are ABC for someone, the side view will show an A on the front view, you know, a B on the side view, a C on the, you know, on one of the other views. And they are done through, you know, so I don't make them myself. I get a commission from each one because I designed the letters, and this man who does them as part of a 3D printing business, you know, you can place the orders with me. I forward them to him. And now, you know, these have not sold very well. The people, you know, who got them like them a lot, but it's not really been a fast seller. In fact, the things that I've done better with have been a couple of things to do with handwriting. I do produce something that is sold by a major occupational therapy company called Therapro.com, Therapro.com. I actually make a couple of products for them. And one, which is a rather new product, is called Trion, T-R-I-O-N, which is basically a writing grip, a little piece of rubber to cook in the pen. It has a triangular shape, but you can turn it inside out and get a whole different shape. And I'm not going to describe it, because if you go to Therapro.com and you put T-R-I-O-N in the search box, it'll come right up. The other thing I did for them, which they still sell, you know, what they've been selling for decades, is a set of handwriting practice paper formats called Stage Write, W-R-I-T-E. And these are designed to solve some of the problems that I had with keeping lines straight. They're papers that have a raised line for the letters to sit on, and they have other lines to guide different parts of the letters. It's a set of six different designs, and one of them has lines for like most features of a letter, for like the tall parts, the descender parts, and whatever. And every step after that fades out a different feature, so that eventually you get something very close to typical notebook paper.
That's so pretty cool.
I've had, and those are both from Therapro.com. There's also products I sell on my own, which I call, get this, the Super Stylus Script Tip Tastic Pen.
Ooh.
And what it is, the ballpoint pen, where the stylus, where the writing tip, if you retract it, that writing tip turns into a computer stylus, so that you can write and go to your computer without having to turn the pen upside down every time. You know, people go, write, computer.
Yeah.
So you can avoid that. Also, the pen has a little pull-out strip of paper hidden in the barrel that when you pull it out, it's spring-loaded inside the pen. It has actual guidance for little quick tips to improve the legibility and efficiency of your handwriting.
Huh.
Now, it doesn't sell... Now, Therapro does not carry that one. That has not sold. That has not sold as well. But, you know, Therapro does not carry that one. One place that has carried it in the past, I don't think they do now, is called NationalAutismResources.com. They carry the paper, they carry the grips, and they used to carry the pen. But they say the demand for the pens hasn't been as big as for the other two. So if you want to see them, you could say, you could always go to NationalAutismResources.com and say, I heard from Kate Gladstone that she designed a handwriting pen. Do you guys know anything about that?
Okay.
They don't carry it in their catalog. Now, so you don't want to say, I want the pen, but you say, I heard Kate Gladstone designed a pen to help with handwriting, you know, do you know anything about it, because I know Kate has done some stuff for you, which is true. I actually wrote an article for their blog once, and I am going to be interviewed in their newsletter in April, so they know perfectly well who I am, so that way. And actually, you can actually order the pens directly from me. There's a link on my website, but the pens have a website on their own, of their own, https, as in springtime, /www.pen.guide. So there's no .com, no .gov, it's .gov.
Oh, very
so
good.
https://www.pen.guide. And if you place orders, I am more than happy to fill them. Although, frankly, who knows, maybe I'll pick up a distributor for the pens. The pens have done pretty well, you know, selling them in workshops and conferences, you know, line, but well, you know, who knows, maybe we will change that. After all, it took a long time for Post-its to take off too, and now everyone uses them.
Right. And you have a patent on that pen, don't you?
Well, patent is on something else. The patent is expired. The pen that I have now is not patentable because it basically combines existing designs, but the patent that I have, which is expired, was for one of the earliest pen computing systems, which was a handwriting signature identification system that would look at the actual pressures of your fingers and basically not only determine if you were the person who was the authorized user, but if you were in your right mind at the time, as opposed, in other words, it was intended for people like bank employees who might be held up. If the bank was locked by a signature, you obviously wanted not only to have the authorized user sign his name, but have him sign it without his hand shaking. If he's got a gun pulled on him, no. The other possible use, we were hoping to have it as a lock for cars so that a car could not be driven by someone who was drunk or on drugs if the authorized user had signed his signature on buying the car when he was sober. But it was never built, but once it expired, other tech parts of it were picked up by some of the other pen computing and electronic stylus companies. By the way, I realize I have one of my handwriting pens here. I'm going to see if I can put this down. I want to prop this up so I can have both hands free. And this is, watch this.
Okay.
You actually have little diagrams, writing, you have little tips. And the nice thing about it is the people who buy it tend to be the people who are sort of too old and too cool for handwriting class. Our biggest demographic is preteen boys, and our second biggest demographic is basically techies and business people of all ages. I actually just sold a lot of them to someone in the business improvement association of a nearby town. So they're the sort of thing that sell better. So if you want these, and of course they have, not only do they have a nice little shaped grip, but actually the large size of my try-on pen grip fits right on them. So you have a very nice integrated product. And here, you probably can't see, I'm trying to get into, here you can see the point and see right computer, right?
Uh-huh.
As opposed to every other stylus pen where you're like, right, computer.
Right. So, okay, cool.
If you want to see, you know, if you want to see the try-ons or you want to see the paper, well, therapro.com has that. Remember, stage, write, WRITE for the paper, and try-on, TRION for the grip.
Okay, very good. And on that note, I think we've run out of time, but yeah, it's been a pleasure talking to you, Kate.
It was really nice hearing your stories.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye.